Is it what crazy? Or autocracy? Or what type of crazy is that? Except crazy.
News making the headlines.
Black Maria is to carry criminals, trading looters that are in government today.
Sometimes it gets confrontational.
Slap you in the face.
Excuse me, don't put words into my mouth.
Whatever it is that will bring our military to discipline. I said, oh, hell
on Cold Digest.
I want to know why I should be believing them.
Every weekday, we bring all of these together and take them to the court of public opinion.
Everybody have your right in Nigeria.
Where you are the judge.
Thanks for joining us again. It's Cold Digest, exclusive to Cold TV News. Mr. President is back in Nigeria, but his trip to America still, memories of his trip, no doubt still linger on. We're talking about the issues of corruption that were raised in the very historic interview he had with Christian Amanpour on CNN, talking about the fact that some ex-ministers are culpable. Selling as much as a million barrels of oil per day. The fact that America needs to help not only to get the funds back, but to also check some other challenges as regards security. On the show today, we're looking at Mr. President's visit to America and some of the matters arising. I'm joined by broadcast journalist Kazim Kasali. Thank you very much for finding time to come today.
Thanks for having me.
Let's start from the visit itself. You know, we can quickly compare it. I believe the MCR will show us what transpired sometimes in the 80s when the Prime Minister, so to speak, visited 60s. America, you know, in the 60s, I beg your pardon, and the kind of aura that came with it. Right at the airport, you saw the Vice President, almost the top three, you know, men in the United States at that time, waiting for him at the airport. From the airport all the way through where he went, there were people on the street celebrating the Nigerian leader. What exactly would you say has changed since that time? You know, I'm not sure Buhari experienced this much of glamour in this recent visit.
Well, a whole lot of things have changed. In the 60s, when Tafa Balewa, I believe, visited the United States of America, Nigeria as a nation was just fresh from independence, a British colony. A whole lot of the bigger powers in the world were trying to cut Nigeria, trying to get on the positive side of this new emerging power from Africa. Mm. But when you now look at then, everybody wanted to cut Nigeria, the Western world, and when you take into consideration the fact that at that period there was what many people refer to as the Cold War on. So the Western bloc, the Warsaw Pact countries, everybody was trying to cut this new emerging power from Africa. So it was more like we Nigeria. It wasn't something out of the ordinary for you to expect to see the Vice President of the United States of America, the Secretary of State, and all the big guns lining up to welcome the Prime Minister. It was a case of let's bring them into our fold. So, but now, when you look at what happened when President Buhari just visited, and you realize the fact that Nigeria is a power that had been on the wane for a long time. So Nigeria is trying to emerge from this abyss.
Well, you know, there are many people who are saying really that if this administration is going to succeed, that we need to look less to the West for help, because we're seeing a video here that dates back to the 60s. We're talking about a bilateral relation that is decades old. I mean, there are people who are asking that didn't the West contribute to much of, you know, the situation we find ourselves as a country today? What better things really do they have to offer after about 4 or 5 decades?
Well, for me, I would not subscribe to this argument that we should look less to the West. Fine, we should look at all other sources, like say China, like the Arab world, like all the other blocs that we can we can draw to get Nigeria to where we truly belong. In a process of trying to get better, in a process of trying to develop, in a process of trying to assert yourself in the world, as in the Committee of Nations, as a preeminent power, you cannot, for now, we cannot afford to say, let's look less to the West. If you look at Africa as it is now, geopolitically, South Africa is a major threat to Nigeria's preeminence on the African continent. And when you look at what most politicians in the Western world, even in the Eastern world, led by Russia, China, and all of them, everybody seems to be looking at South Africa. And that is why these coinage, BRICS countries, India, China, South Africa, and Brazil, that is BRICS. So South Africa is seen more as a developing power, as an emerging power. So Nigeria has been left behind. So if we, as a nation, will get back that prestige, that presence, and that power, and the preeminence on the African continent, we have to look at all other sources, all the other sources, not to say we're not looking at the Western power. Fine. Some of the problems we may have today may be traceable to the fact that our leaders took things from the Western world, hook, line, and sinker, without really taking a look at it and applying it in such a way that it will fit the Nigerian situation. Take, for instance, the IMF Structural Adjustment Program. Nigeria was not the only country that did the Structural Adjustment Program, but we emerged the worst for it. Several other countries also did it, and they are still there. And it was because when we did it, we just took it and applied it, not thinking of the fact that what applies in America, what applies in the UK, what applies in Brazil will not necessarily apply in Nigeria.
Now, there's a need to domesticate it and ensure that it fits into the peculiar situation of the Nigerian nation. I understand quite all right, but the increase in the international oil prices is not also helping matters, because that seems to be the greatest tie that Nigeria has with the Western world, with America producing its own oil. And the fact that there is a need for us to look more onto the inside, I mean, look more inside than outward. We're talking about agriculture, mining, and also alternative source of power. You still see the West playing a major role in all of this?
Well, for me, a lot of people don't just get it. And I'm pretty disappointed that even some of those who are supposed to be policymakers in Nigeria seems to be gravitating towards saying that the U.S. is producing its oil and all of that. Fine, the U.S. is producing shale oil, but it is not financially viable for them to produce at the level that crude oil can be produced as of now. So for me, the case of saying increase in price of oil is a major problem between us and the West. We are not the only oil-producing nation, for crying out loud. Saudi Arabia is there. Saudi Arabia is the largest producer. Iran, which is the second largest producer, has been off the market for some time. So for me, what we have now in the world oil market is just a glut that is going to go away after some time. We've seen these fluctuations before. In the late 90s, 98, 99, oil per barrel was selling for as low as $7 per barrel. Nigeria did not collapse. All we had then were fantastic stories of people stealing money, driving bullion vans into the central bank and cutting away cash, running to several millions of dollars. So for me, that is of no effect. But for what we have to do now as a nation, some of the dividends that the president's visit has brought to us in the last few days was this, the World Bank approval of $2.1 billion for Nigeria to develop other sectors. So it is an opportunity for us. And going by the fact that we have a new president, a new government in place that is talking about changing the way we have run our economy. Nigeria's economy has been run aground in the last 10 years, really. People have just decided to go about doing things without thinking of, okay, what is the impact of what we are doing today? A whole lot of revenue that should accrue to the Federation account has disappeared, and nobody can say this is where they are. Where you recall the issue with Malabo, you recall the issue with the Petroleum Equalization Fund and all of that. So it is an opportunity for us to get back to where we truly belong. Nigeria was the number one producer of palm oil in the 60s. Malaysia came here to take the palm oil seeds, and now Malaysia is
and
the number
doing
one
producer,
and they are doing tremendously well. So all the countries in the world that have really developed, they have not developed based on their natural resources. They've developed based on their human resources. They've developed based on their manufacturing sector. They developed based on the kind of knowledge that they can give to the world. People will come there, they will pay a whole lot of money to acquire knowledge. People will come there on tourism and all of that. Those are sectors that we should develop as a nation. Not just that somebody will just carry a briefcase at the end of the month, go to Abuja for federal allocation account committee meeting. After it all, everybody disappears to their state. They wait for another 30 days and go back there. And at the end of the day, we can't really say this is where the money is going to. So for me, the president going to the United States of America will bring dividends to us. And also, when you look at remittances from people who have lived outside of Nigeria, we call them Nigerians in the diaspora. When you look at records by the World Bank, the United States government, and all of that, in the last 10 years, Nigerians have remitted billions of dollars annually back home. So if we encourage a whole lot of Nigerians who are out there, who are really eager to come home to put money into the Nigerian economy and develop it, we encourage them to come back home, put their money where their mouth is, then we can develop better. With all these oil price and all of that, we should just make a big paradigm shift and start looking at other sectors.
Let's quickly highlight some of the issues that came up in Mr. President's visit to America. And I love that we start with security. In one of his interview with the media, he was quoted to have said that he's ready to negotiate with Boko Haram if it would lead to the release of the Chibok girls. You recall that this issue of negotiation also came up even before he went to America. I believe sometimes last month, where Femi Adesina says that, well, it's from a more advantaged position this time if there will ever be a negotiation. I mean, doesn't it sound like we're dancing around the bush? You recall the last administration, there was a time the Nigerian military talked about a possible negotiation ongoing, that there was a ceasefire deal. That was exactly what they said. And you and I know what followed afterwards.
Well, for me, when you look at the policies of countries who have faced these kind of challenges before, the smart move is not to negotiate with terrorists, because they will come back for more.
But it's even amazing that he's saying it in America, a country whose policy is we don't negotiate with terrorists.
Well, it's amazing for you, but for people who are close watchers of the security system and who have a keen interest in what goes on in the defense wise and other associated sectors, you realize the fact that even the United States of America, France, and all of them, they will tell you they don't negotiate with terrorists. We don't negotiate with terror. We are firm. We go for them wherever they are. George Bush said of Osama bin Laden, wanted dead or alive. But the point is, they've also find a way to negotiate.
Probably not
Taliban,
open to the media.
Not open to the media. There have been prisoner swaps between the United States of America and the Taliban and all of that. So for me, if we can get an authentic branch of Boko Haram to negotiate with, at least for the freedom of these girls. They've been away for over a year now. I'm pretty sure a lot of them would have been converted to terrorists, as per what psychologists will refer to as the Stockholm Syndrome. They begin to have a sort of sympathy with their abductors and all of that. And from accounts of people who have been released, who have been released by the military from the Sambisa Forest enclave of the Boko Haram, who have said that they've seen some of the Chibok girls being involved in killings and all of that. So it is better if we can get the authentic Boko Haram branch to negotiate with, because as far as I'm concerned, the Boko Haram thing, they may be represented by Shekau or whoever is posing as the leader now. But the point is, it has been fragmented, where you see a whole lot of different tactics being employed. You know that there are different branches of, we have Ansarullah, we have all sorts of people masquerading as Boko Haram. So it will be good if we can get the authentic branch of Boko Haram. But the big question is, will we be able to get the authentic faction of Boko Haram? Taking into consideration what happened with the last attempt at getting a ceasefire deal done. So for me, if we can get the Boko Haram faction, the authentic one, to negotiate for the freedom of the Chibok girls, fine. But the federal government must negotiate from a position of absolute strength, not a position of weakness that we've always been negotiating from. We should have them by through the barriers of the gun. It's either take it or leave it approach that we should take when negotiating with them. We should negotiate from a position.
This is strength is relative, you know, but I don't know how you would define strength. Would you say negotiation at this time for the federal government is from a position of strength, given the, you know, incessant, almost daily experience of suicide attacks in Nigeria?
Well, nobody is really sure of what goes on on the battlefield. We hear all sorts of stories. We have them on the run. We have liberated Goza. We have liberated Konduga. We've liberated all sorts of places. But the point still remains that until there is a stop to these daily attacks, until we can get a situation where we get people who are actually backing them. Because for me, the trick in getting Boko Haram to its knees is when we stop the flow of money. When you look at the experience of the United States of America with Al Qaeda and the ISIS and all of them, it's always been a scaling up. A scaling up always happens when they are able to stop the flow of money to them. When the flow of money to Al Qaeda was stopped, we all knew what happened with Osama bin Laden. Went on the run even till today. Al Qaeda may be there, they are existing, but not as strong as it was pre 9/11. So we have to find a way to stem the flow of finance, of money into the coffers of Boko Haram. And that I think is one of the reasons that the president has to go to the United States of America, because the Americans have a whole lot of experience in addressing this kind of issues.
Now, when you talk about a whole lot of experience, not many people will agree with you that America as a nation has recorded a level of consistent success in that region, given the experience in Syria, in places like Iraq, in Libya. And you know that when Americans, you know, bring soldiers down, or they involve in the ongoing war against terrorism in a particular region, of course, you hear about some remarkable experience, but subsequent experiences aren't that palatable. But you might also recall what US president said, that he sees our president as being focused in the ongoing fight against insurgency. But the question has really been, where exactly do we need America at this time, given the stance the country took after the abduction of the Chibok girls? They were here, they promised to help. What has changed thus far?
Well, a whole lot has changed. When the Chibok girls were abducted, the Americans came with some of their security agents and all of that. And one of the reasons that led to their departure, I believe, was the fact that there were a lot of leaks. You know, in security parlance, especially when it affects dealing with terrorists, you need a lot of security cover. You need absolute confidentiality for you to be able to do things without everybody being in the know before you do it. But in the case of Nigeria, the CDS will say something today, we get something different from the defense headquarters telling us this is what has happened and all of that. So all this modeled up sphere of communication was a problem, I believe, and that was why they left. And even before they came to Nigeria, they'd already given us an opportunity for them to help us in taking out Boko Haram. You recall, even just yesterday, the top Al-Qaeda operative was killed by the United States in an airstrike, not by a fighter jet, but by a drone. So, and beside us here in the Niger Republic, they already have a drone base that we can make good use of. But the last administration did not really tap into that window of opportunity, because when you see, most oftentimes when you see Shekau or anybody who is appearing in videos on behalf of Boko Haram, they do it on the open field with SUVs parked all over them, with people branding Kalashnikovs, wearing face masks and all of that. So if they are doing this, they are not going to do it in, say, 1 or 2 minutes. People will be aware that something like that is happening. So if we have a country like America who has the capabilities that we do not have, they have drones that we can, okay, let's have a sort of partnership where you have drones flying all over the northeastern parts of Nigeria, especially the Sambisa forest, and you can now relay the information to our military forces. One of the reasons the Americans left initially was because they felt the Nigerian army was not ready to fight until mercenaries, military contractors and all sorts of people were brought in to help in the final push to liberate some of the areas that that was under Boko Haram occupation. So I believe if we tap into this opportunity, we can do better. It's not a case of saying the Americans don't have a consistent level of success in this regard. And when you say consistent, it's relative. In the period pre 9/11, there were a lot of terrorist attacks by Al-Qaeda and other associated terror groups all over. In Kenya, we knew what happened. Even in Kenya, in Mombasa, aside the Nairobi attacks on the U.S. embassy, we knew what happened in Mombasa when somebody nearly brought down a Boeing 737 full of Americans and Israelis. So, but when you look at what has happened after 9/11, you see that there is a considerable level of reduction in the attacks that have been mounted, even in the scale. The USS Cole was attacked by an Al-Qaeda operative in Yemen. That was pre 9/11. So a whole lot of the scale has reduced. The level of the constant level of attacks has also reduced, and it's because the US has done a lot of things. And also, why we are having a problem in the Northeast, don't forget, is because the people on ground, the local population, do not trust the Nigerian military.
We'll get back to that. We'll open the phone lines quite early on the show today. As soon as your call is acknowledged, please go ahead with your contribution. Plus, do endure to turn down the volume of your TV set so we can have a crystal clear communication ongoing on the show today. Let's have your opinion about Mr. President's visit to the States and some of the issues that came up thereafter. Of course, I'm talking about the level of involvement of the United States, you know, in helping Nigeria and some of these issues. Prior to Mr. President visit, there were lots of protests and complaints about not agreeing with American policy on gay rights in exchange for the American help. Of course, the presidency earlier, I believe yesterday, confirmed that President Muhammadu Buhari rejected the idea of gay marriage. That means that it came up, you know, in the series of meetings he had as soon as it was raised in the course of his ongoing official visit to the States. You know how strong the gay policy is in America, apart from the gay right. Recently, they also passed the marriage rights, you know, for homosexuals in that region. Do you see Nigeria and America working closely hand in hand, even with such sharp differences in ideology?
Well, I believe we can work together with the United States of America. There are a whole lot of countries that are seen as the allies of America, and they do not agree on a wide range of issues. Take, for instance, Saudi Arabia, who is seen as the major ally of the United States of America, especially in the Gulf and Arab region. Saudi Arabia does carry out executions, public floggings, and all of that. Those are things that are majorly Islamic.
We also saw a renewed ties, you know, between America and Cuba recently. Just a minute. Let me take this call and find out who's on the line.
Hello?
Good morning. Welcome to
Hello?
Call Digest.
Hello.
What's your name, please,
Hello?
And where are you calling from?
Hello. Are you hearing me?
Yes, I can hear you. If you turn down the volume of your TV set.
Hello.
Please try again. Were you calling in and able to turn down the volume of your TV set so that we can hear you clearly? Right. There's a lot about communication. They say it's not much about what you say, but what the other person's hear. Looks as if we are yet together culture of communication, right, in Nigeria. And we have all the telecommunications company to blame for it. You keep saying hello, hello, and the other person on the other side of the phone isn't hearing a beat of what you say. Hello, good morning. Good morning, what's your name and where are you calling from? All right. I can hardly hear you. Please speak up. Okay, let's get back to this. You were talking about the fact that there are certain other countries that America isn't in tandem with, and they seem to be working well together.
Yes, like Saudi Arabia, like Cuba, that has been under American sanctions for so long, for over 50 years now. They've just renewed ties. American embassy in Havana was opened, the Cuban embassy in Washington as well being reopened. So the fact that you disagree on some issues does not preclude you from working together for me. So the fact that we have issues with the United States, especially on gay rights and maybe on the conduct of our military in the war against terror, that does not stop us from working together. It was the inability of the past administration to navigate this that has led us here.
Let me take this call. Hello, good morning.
Hello, good morning.
What's your name and where are you calling from?
Rashid calling from Gabon.
Rashid from Gabon. Please go ahead with your contribution.
Thank you very much for this show this morning. It's just so pity that when we wanted this Boko Haram issue to be up from Nigeria, our government are not taking new money and their own way. You know, I don't know what they're able to do. We want to fight Boko Haram, but they are taking money. All the same, all I know, we pray that maybe that one day all these issues will come to pass. For the trip that the president made, it was just a good decision. And we all pray that good
things
will come out of it.
All right, Rashid, thank you.
And I wanted to add again, excuse me, I wanted to add something, an advice. You know, when America stopped this issue of guns, ammunition, they don't want to sell it for us. So we need to work this out ourselves. They are blocking all those power nations, all those nations that can supply us with ammunition. They are blocking them to give us ammunition to fight those people out. So all I'm saying is, let us come back and do our own our own homework, and we have all these men of God in Nigeria. Let us go to them and find like we need to do before.
It's all right. Rashid, thank you very much for your contribution from Gabon and giving us a spiritual way out of the challenge. It's making sense, really, because given the volume and the concentration of religious belief in this part of the world, if prayer alone was going to do it, I'm of the opinion that prayer would have done it a long time ago. But it also shows us that there are other efforts that, you know, we need to embark on. But let's talk about, he raised an issue. There was a time during the Jonathan administration where the reason why some cash were found on a private airline en route to South Africa was that Nigeria was planning to buy ammunition via the black market because America had laid an embargo on such bilateral trade, given reasons of violation of human rights. Looks as if we've never been that much of friends, even at the face of terrorist attacks in the country.
Well, people tend to place a lot of premium on things that are innocuous, that are just normal practices by the United States of America. When you look at the statutes and laws of the United States of America, there is an embargo that was placed specifically by Congress on the transfer of military equipment, arms and ammunition, or even training to countries whose military have been accused of human rights violations. So if the United States of America was doing that at that point, it was just the normal American practice, though there have been exceptions for countries like, say, Israel, that has been long-standing allies of the United States of America. But within the same period also, if you recall, Egypt was also denied access to some military equipment that would have been transferred to them based solely on the overthrow of the then President Mohamed Morsi by the military led by Abdel Fattah Sisi. So it's not as if Nigeria was the only country that was affected.
You said Nigeria really wasn't an exception at that time.
It wasn't an exception.
Let me take this call very quickly. Hello, good morning.
Hello, good morning.
What's your name, please, and where are you calling from?
Oh, you are speaking with Mr. Kingsley Oyeri. I'm calling from Kaduna State.
Mr. Kingsley Oyeri, thank you very much for calling on the show this morning. Please go ahead with your contribution.
Okay, I want to contribute issue of the negotiation.
Okay.
Buhari issue. I think for me, the issue of negotiation, you don't negotiate with the terrorists. And for me, I'm not in support. I think for me, if you look at the past government, they were able to they have Nigeria to give them 6 weeks to handle Boko Haram. And within that 6 weeks, they were able to, they bought some ammunition, which they were able to fight the Boko Haram. I think for me, all you have to do is just go and check. All you have to do is just equip the military, get ammunition, more ammunition, and fight with Boko Haram. I think if really our military will come.
I'm afraid we lost that call, Oyeri from Kaduna, but I believe you made your point as well. Thank you for calling on the show today. And there are lots of people like him who are making reference to the success recorded by the Jonathan administration in the last few weeks, you know, of his tenure. It worked, really. I didn't know what they did, but they talked about a regional force that was working together at that time. You have to note the dimension with which Boko Haram is working. There are reports that they had laid siege on the hometown, even not, you know, the residents of the present new chief of defense staff, you know, Buratai. It looks like a very determined, deliberate attack, calling for the similar approach that Jonathan used in that 6 weeks.
Well, most Nigerians, I believe, we suffer from amnesia, especially as it regards
selective amnesia.
Now, when you look at what happened during the 6 weeks that the Jonathan administration was able to really curtail the spread of Boko Haram, especially in major population centers in the northeast, it wasn't as if Boko Haram was defeated. They were merely pushed out of major population centers by the army. They were beaten back. Why? Because at that point, the military was, the federal government was, they were able to secure some weapons that were not in play in the preceding months, like the MiG 35 in-hand attack helicopters, which is what the federal government is also calling for from the United States of America. In the kind of warfare that Boko Haram is waging, the kind of way they've been waging war, you do not need to have a fighter jet to be able to fight them. All you need is the attack helicopters that can come in smartly and be able to pinpoint their targets and attack. So, and United States seems to be the country that has the preeminence, especially in terms of having such types of equipment like the Apache helicopters, like the Tiger attack helicopters. So that is what the federal government have not been able to get from the United States of America, even during the period that the former president, Goodluck Jonathan, was in power. So, but at the point when they got some of these helicopters from Russia and some other countries, especially through the black market, and some of them were also brought in by military contractors that were paid by the federal government. So a lot of people will say the military, but a lot of efforts went into those 6 weeks to get things done.
The bottom line was that in those areas where Boko Haram had put their flags, you know, it was removed, and there were lesser suicide attacks. I think that was simply what Nigerians needed.
Well, most
whatever
people,
it is was done. Is
what
it,
happened at that point wasn't just a case of them putting Boko Haram on the run. Fine, Boko Haram was on the run. So after a period of time that Boko Haram now realized that they can no longer wage the kind of warfare of, okay, we are coming to take Konduga, we've taken Konduga, we've planted our flags there, this one belongs to us as the Islamic Caliphate, like they erroneously thought they were starting their own nation. What happened was that once the military got its act together and were able to chase them out of major population centers, a change of tact happened. Boko Haram now realized the fact that they cannot face the military because the military now has better weapons. Not necessarily that the soldiers were better trained, but they had better leadership, they had better weapons, owing to the fact that some other people joined them, especially military contractors, mercenaries from Europe.
Let me just hold you for a minute and take this. Hello, good morning.
Good morning.
Now, what's your name and where are you calling from?
This is Anichebu from Benue State.
Anichebu from Benue State.
Amikebu.
Thank you for your call. Please go ahead with your contribution, Amikebu.
Yes, I think the issue of the amnesty for Boko Haram, I don't agree that they should be given amnesty or any kind of negotiation to be allowed. They are theorists, and I have not seen or heard in the world that the terrorists are being negotiated with. So I think the issue of negotiation should be kept aside. You know, any kind of negotiation, whether the ones that are truly Boko Haram or the ones that are not truly Boko Haram, terrorists are terrorists. They can come in, you know, they can come out, you know, in the guise that they, you know, they are repentant. But one has to be very careful. I have not heard, you know, any place in the world that terrorists are, you know, are being given amnesty or being negotiated with. Then in the case of the Buhari's visit to, you know, to America, what I think is that we should be very careful on how we trade with America, knowing that they cannot be trusted. We saw what happened in the last administration, where they promised that we help Nigeria, and in the court, we all saw what happened. They withdrew their support for Nigeria. So I think we should not keep all our eggs in one basket. We should also
go to Russia.
How is it like China, like, you know, the additional countries that we think they are very important, just like the US do. So the visit to America, though it is important, but we should not put all our eggs in one basket. And we should also trade with caution, because this issue of we seeking for aid, we don't know what they want from us. So we should also be talking about what they want in return for the aid they are giving us.
Thank you, Amikebu from Benue. Didn't it make some sense? Nigeria provides one of the largest markets for China products. So why not also go to China?
Well, like I rightly pointed out earlier, when this issue of, okay, can we go to America? We can, but we also need to take into cognizance other big players on the international scene, China, Russia, and all of them. In trying to assert yourself, you cannot say, I don't want to deal with America, I don't want to deal with Russia. You take everything. It is when you are now strong enough, when you are in a position of strength, that you can say, okay, to hell with so.
One more call. Hello, good morning. Welcome to Call Digest.
Hello.
What's your name, please, and where are you calling from?
Okay, my name is Babangida.
Babangida from where?
My name is Babangida from Natural State.
Babangida, thank you for calling. Go ahead with your contribution.
Natural State.
I heard that. Go ahead with your contribution, please.
Natural State.
I got that, Babangida.
My contribution is that Now, our Nigeria armies, we talk of issue of the Nigeria and the Nigeria generals, so they are not helping matters at all. The issue of Boko Haram in Borno, those officers, if you look at what Obasanjo did during his regime, Obasanjo bring a junior officer to become a chief of army staff, which the rest of the generals returned. What General Muhammadu Buhari is supposed to do, he did this so. Or some of these generals, they are not helping matters. Our junior officers are suffering by killing innocent people over there. When these senior officers are not doing anything, to think what to do, we have youth that they are ever ready to work. They should help and promote junior youth. They should go and do the work. If the senior ones are not ready to work, they should leave the work. Some people will do it.
It's all right, Babangida. I believe you made your point there. When you call in on the show, turn down the volume of your TV set so that you can be more apt to your contribution. You know, there's a feedback mechanism because it's a digital TV. Seems to be some seconds delay between what we say in the studio and what you hear on your TV set. So when you call in, ensure that your TV is mute and so we can hear you clearly. There are other issues that, you know, came up in that particular trip to America. Mr. President also talked about corruption. We recall that Rashid, who called earlier from Gabon, talked about how impossible it is to fight Boko Haram on one hand and have it done by corrupt leaders. Mr. President talked about close to 1 million barrels of oil, you know, being sold out by ex-ministers and all of that. Where does the American country or the American nation come in now in this regard?
Well, you recall the other time we were talking about oil theft, and you realize the gargantuan number that is being told us is disappearing monthly, daily, weekly, and it seems to be an exact number.
You seem to know
exactly the number of barrels that is being stolen. Mm. Why we can't really say this is how much we are producing.
On the other side, we can't tell how many liters of petrol Nigerians consume on a daily basis.
So is that not an indication of the fact that leadership before now, I wouldn't know what is going on now, but I do believe and expect that hope that what Nigerians have voted for in change, in saying that, okay, we want a departure from this abysmal level of performance, especially from our leaders, to an accountable leadership, to a leadership that cares about the people. Most of the problems we have today, you can trace it to corruption. Even the problem within the military, the issue of not being able to equip the military well enough. You recall that between 1999 and 2014 or 15 that we are in, a lot of money. When you sit down and take a look at the figures that are being bandied about that are as allocation to the military, either for soldiers' welfare, either for purchase of equipment by the military. When you look at the figure, it's so big, and you begin to wonder where is this this thing coming from, that the military is poorly equipped, and you see a band of ragtag army, all in the name of Boko Haram, chasing the military out of most of the major population centers in the northeast. Before we now got Chad, Niger, Cameroon, and some other tiny African countries that would normally shiver when Nigeria talks, and we now got them to now help us to chase Boko Haram out, to now confine them to an enclave in the Sambisa forest, from where they've been sending out 10-year-old girls, 50-year-old women, and all sorts of people as suicide bombers on a daily basis. It beggars belief when you consider that. But when you also trace this, you trace it to corruption, because you ask yourself, where is all this money? Where have they gone? Where have they flown to? Because Some people are claiming that the Nigerian government has not equipped the military since 1985.
Hello, good morning.
Good morning, sir.
You're welcome to Call Digest. What's your name and where are you calling from?
I'm calling from Kaduna.
What's your name, please?
My name is Adamu, sir.
Adamu?
Yes.
Mr. Adamu, can you turn down the volume of your TV set for me?
Yes.
All right, please go ahead with your contribution.
Yes, yes, my contribution. And can you hear me?
Very clearly. I can hear your baby's voice too. Go ahead with your contribution. I'm afraid there's something wrong with that line.
Hello?
Go ahead. We can hear you clearly. Please okay. Go ahead.
My contribution is about the, Buhari should retire all the channels.
I'm afraid we lost that. Keep trying. The moment you call is acknowledged, turn down the volume of your TV set so we can hear you clearly. People keep seeing something wrong with the leadership of the military. There are many people who said that Mr. President was too slow to have sacked the former service chiefs. Now that he's done it, it looks like people are still not satisfied with the changes he has made.
Well, as far as I'm concerned, he was not slow. You can't just come in, when the people seem to compare this to what former President Olusegun Obasanjo did in 1999. People seem to compare this, but there are two different circumstances. When Obasanjo was coming in, it was people who are service chiefs have been there as military, they've been leading the country as military men. There was no democratic government in place. So for him to take a sharp departure from the past, he needed to remove all the service chiefs and appoint those he feels he can work with. But when you now look at what is happening with Buhari, we are coming from a war situation in the Northeast. A new president is coming in. Some service chiefs have been in place. They've been prosecuting the war for quite some time. So the president needs to sit down, take a look at what they've done, meet with them, be sure
understand
the situation. Mm-hmm. Be sure that they are in tandem with what he feels he should be. The military should be doing. And if after a period of meetings, trying to take a look at what is happening, briefings and all of that, if the president now feels okay, these people cannot go. I cannot go ahead with these people in ensuring that the vision I have for the military to prosecute this war, these people cannot do it. Then he goes ahead and removes them. So for me, it was not slow. It was just being deliberate and meticulous about the whole matter.
Good morning. Welcome to Call Digest. What's your name?
Good morning. I'm calling from Makande, Mr. Ifezue.
Mr. Ifezue?
Yeah, Mr. Ifezue.
All right, go ahead with your contribution.
I'm calling.
Please turn down the volume of your TV set and go ahead with the contribution.
Okay, my contribution is that the president is meeting. My own is that the president be admitting before President Obama that without Obama, we and America, Nigeria can't do election. It's a wrong signal from the presidency because tomorrow America will use it against him. So if he thinks he's doing well by telling Obama that we have him, Nigeria will have done credible election. Nigeria wouldn't have done credible election, that the past government wouldn't have done credible election. America will later use it to fight him. That's what I'm saying.
It's all right. Your point is made quite clear, Mr. Emma Efezue from Makurdi. Looks as if you have to be very careful whatever you say when you're with Obama. But let's talk about the U.S. president visit to Kenya. There are insinuations that Barack Obama left Mr. President in America and went for a meeting in Nairobi, talking about the Pre-Global Entrepreneurship Summit 2015 Expo. And this issue is also causing some uproar on social media. Some are saying, well, if Obama knew he was going to Kenya, why didn't he just come and visit Buhari in Nigeria rather than ask him to come over all the way to America? Is this something big enough to to cause the kind of concern and worry it's causing in Nigeria?
Concern, fine, because, but like I rightly pointed out, Nigeria has, we've lost so much prestige, presence, and power on the continent that an American president will come to Africa, will come to neighboring Ghana and some other countries, and he will not visit Nigeria. So if Obama has invited Buhari over, come over, I believe the president has an itinerary that does not say that he will be in the White House for 4 days. He has met with Obama, he has met with the Vice President, he has met with the Secretary of State, who for me is the third most powerful person in the United States, especially in the executive arm of government. He has met with three of them within the first 2 days of his visit. He has other things to do, like a visit to the American Security Institute, a meeting with Nigerians in the diaspora and all of that. So for me, the fact that Obama will also have his own engagement, so he cannot put everything on hold because Buhari is in America. You understand? So for me, Obama has left. Buhari has done what he's gone to America to do. He has met Obama. He has met those people he's supposed to meet. But still, one will ask if Obama will leave a British prime minister in America and go to Kenya.
What a way to end your contribution of that. Well, we hope that probably subsequently I will also discuss these issues. Broadcast journalist Kazim Kasali, thank you very much for finding time to join us on the show.
Thanks for having me.
A big thank you to our callers, Rashid Corden, all the way from Gabon. And we also had a call from Mr. Yeri in Kaduna, and Mick Cable Corden from Benue, Babangida from Nasarawa, Adamo from Kaduna, and Efizwe from Makurdi. And the phone keeps buzzing. We're going to open the phone line yet again tomorrow on the show so that you can make all your contributions. I'm Nifani. We're going to hear. Thank you for watching.